In our first lesson, we're going to be looking at an overview of the book to kind of get it in our minds exactly what time frame that we are looking at and when Ezekiel spoke. One clear thing is that Jeremiah that we've studied, he went right through the destruction of Jerusalem, didn't he? He lived after that and dealt with the events that transpired even after, that's why he wrote the book of Lamentations. Ezekiel was one of the ones that earlier went into earlier captivity, and we'll talk details about that. But he was over there in Babylonian captivity, for Jerusalem was fully destroyed. And there was prophets prophesying that about 2 years we're getting out of here. And we know from Jeremiah, how long would they be in captivity? 70 years. And they're you know, they've been there for a few years and they're thinking they're going to get to come back. And Ezekiel butts heads with those men too. And of course Ezekiel is correct and God is correct, and they were wrong. But he's giving prophecies, and we'll see them somewhat dated. I'll have it on the outlines that you have in the foyer. You'll see, what's 592? It's this date, 597. At least you'll have a idea when that was. So let's look at these last kings. Was Manasseh a good king or an evil king from the things that he did? He was evil. And we're going to find out when Josiah comes along, and we'll talk about it when we speak about Josiah. But Manasseh, the 687 to 642, is a pretty long time for an evil king to come around. You have Ammon, that he was from 642 to 640 BC. And then we have a man by the name of Josiah. Was he a good king, or was he an evil king? He was a good king, 8 years old when he started to rule. He had those who would be mentors to him. But he reformed things, or you think he reformed things. He did reform, but when people's heart is not going to be reformed, they can do a lot of outside changes. Let's just go knock down all of the Asherah that's been worshipped in Jerusalem in the temple. Let's get rid of that, and we'll be okay. And of course, Josiah was a good king. He took things to heart, but this is what was going to take place. And I want us just to see, if you go to 2 Kings, the 23rd and 24th chapter, once you look at 24th chapter, with all the Josiah's reforms that you see in chapter 23, and they're great. Notice what God says on chapter 24, when he speaks in verse 3, "Surely at the commandment of Jehovah came this upon Judah to remove him out of his sight, for the sins of Manasseh, according to all that he did, and also for the innocent blood that he shed. For he filled Jerusalem with innocent blood. Jehovah will not pardon." So here he's speaking about to Josiah. Josiah, you're not going to see the evil I'm going to do to this people. You're not going to see that. You're going to die. Your heart's broken for the things that you've gone through, and we appreciate that. But God had already determined, even with the reforms of Josiah, what Manasseh did was the end of Jerusalem, far as that era is concerned. It's going into captivity. And that tells me God didn't see a heart change. He sees Josiah's heart changing. He appreciates what he has done. But while he's going to be spared to see that evil, "I'm going to bring evil upon Manasseh. I will not pardon what they did." And it's an interesting thing about reform. We may reform things in our time, but God has already determined he's going to destroy our country years ago. And we're trying to change things. If we're in a country, we're politics, but if we're people of the church, we're going to reform things. God may have already determined how the end's going to be. And we just may reform in our time, and hopefully it'll be genuine. Josiah's, not him, but Josiah's people were not obeying from the heart. And that's why it didn't last. That's why the reforms were not there. But he was indeed a good king. And we'll see, he dies at Megiddo trying to fight Pharaoh Necho. Jehoahaz, 608 BC, he only served 3 months. Is that very long? I don't even think you'd get a plaque if you served 3 months as a king, would you? You didn't serve long enough to get you a nice plaque or get you a watch. That did not happen. So it's interesting, Josiah, and of course Jehoahaz was an evil king. Then you have Jehoiakim, and his name was changed to Jehoiakim by Pharaoh Necho. Eliakim was his name, 608 to 597 BC. This is going to be one of the key times for Ezekiel is concerned about him, about Jehoiakim's reign. But this is around that particular time that he's going to be serving. Then there's Jehoiachin. We know him as Coniah, Jeconiah, 597. Right, that he comes upon the scenes, and he only reigns 3 months. But what do we know about his reign? It may be 3 months. I think he was 25 years old when he began to reign in Jerusalem. He's taken into captivity by Pharaoh Necho. And you think, well, he just—that's the end of him, and that's the way, that's how it's going to be. But we know at the end of 2 Kings, it was 25th chapter. Even though Jehoiachin, chapter 24 and verse 8 of 2 Kings, he was 18 years old. When he began to reign, and he reigned in Jerusalem 3 months. So let's say he's 18 years old. Let's go to the last paragraph in 2 Kings 25. Came to pass in the 37th year. So 37 years later, he's 55 years old. What's going on with Jehoiachin? In the 12th month, on the 7th and 20th day of the month, that Evil-Merodach, king of Babylon, in the year that he began to reign, did lift up the head of Jehoiachin, king. And he was kind to him. And he set his throne upon the throne of the kings that were with him in Babylon. And he changed his prison garments. And Jehoiachin did eat bread before him continually all the days of his life. And for his allowance, there was a continual allowance given him of the king every day, a portion all the days of his life. At 55, he did pretty good. He's in Babylon, but he's at the king's table. And he's not beheaded, but he's one that... they saw value anyway, even though he only reigned 3 months in Jerusalem and taken away unceremoniously too. The last king, Zedekiah, 511 years, 597 to 586 BC, is when we see that's when Jerusalem falls and therefore becomes a key time. So let's look at some key events and then we'll put Ezekiel in them. There are three powers at the time when Ezekiel is doing his work, and what we see in the kings, like Josiah and those kings, these last kings of Judah. There was Assyria, there was Egypt, and there were the Chaldeans. We know the Babylonians, the Chaldeans. They were the three powers. And we find the Babylonians fighting against Egypt, and we'll find that Assyria takes the people off in the northern kingdom of Judah. Israel would take them off into captivity. And they were the powers that were there. So what we began to see is that during this time frame, what took place that was indeed eventful? 612 BC. That's a time, we ought to have that in our heads when we study the Bible, but we know this in history. In 612 BC, Nineveh, the capital of Assyria, falls, and it's not Egypt. The Chaldeans are coming on the scene, and they are taking, they're having their power, their moment in the sun, so to speak. In 609 BC, Josiah's killed, as I said earlier, at Megiddo. He was fighting against Pharaoh Necho. He's defended Babylon, the Chaldeans, but indeed there was that triangle there, and he's going out to fight them, and he's killed in battle. And that becomes the end of Josiah, great king, one doing great reforms. But this is how he meets his end. And then we find Nebuchadnezzar takes the first captives from Jerusalem. And that's a key one. This one time of destroying Jerusalem, all the captives go. It was in stages. And one of the first stages was taking away young men that had potential in learning the language, talented men. Maybe their looks helped them. I don't know if they were going to be on TV or not, and that sort of thing. But they were grooming them, and they would learn their language. And Daniel was one of the first ones that went at this first time in 606 BC when that was occurring. And so that was Nebuchadnezzar taking that first wave of people over. It's not until later that Jerusalem is destroyed. Does Daniel ever come out of that? I mean, he's a young man, and he's an old man. Daniel the lion's den. He's not supposed to be praying. And he stays there and prophesies to the people. And yet he's one of the greatest prophets we have. But he didn't get to come back with Ezra. And all those, he did his work there. Egypt falls at Carchemish in 605 BC. And this is when finally Egypt is being overthrown, and they would never become a great power like they were at this time. Babylon is on the rise. They're on the scene. And that's a key time. Right after that Nebuchadnezzar had taken the first captives in Jerusalem. And then 597 is Babylon takes Jerusalem captive, and this is under rule of Jehoiakim that we're noticing there. And that becomes a key date for Ezekiel, because Babylon takes Jehoiachin captive on that occasion, and of course he will be spared and that sort of thing. But there were 10,000 nobles that indeed are taken in captivity. That's a lot of them. You got a lot of the principal men in Daniel and the young men. Now you have these that are well known, and they've become very important. Second Kings, for example, chapter 24. Look at verse 14. This is under at this time of the reign of the kings. He carried away all Jerusalem and all the princes, all the mighty men of valor, even 10,000 captives, and all the craftsmen and the smiths, none remained, save the poor sort of the people of the land. And so there would be Ezekiel going on this particular occasion. So 597 becomes a key part. We're going to take, well, in the 25th year of my captivity, of the captivity. It's not 606 when captivity started for Israel. It's when captivity started for me. And he prophesies, and that point will be 597 BC. And then what's 586? That'll ring in our ears. Babylon, temple, Jerusalem is completely destroyed in 586 BC. And that's when we find that end taking place. So 606 is when captivity begins. When do they come back to Jerusalem with the exiles coming out of Babylonian captivity with the leaders, Nebuchadnezzar, when Nebuchadnezzar is defeated by Cyrus. So if you took 606 and take 70 years, you might come to 536 BC, right on the dot. That's when they come back. And that's where we put Ezra. We put after 70 years, they're not gonna be two more years, we've been here about a couple decades, it's gonna be two more years, we're out of here. And people believe that. Ezekiel says you're believing a lie. But it would be 536 they would rebuild the temple, just like they're supposed to as far as God is concerned. He picked that time, and that's when it happens. So that's Ezekiel comes on the scene at 597 BC. And 586 hadn't occurred yet. Temple's still there. So all signs, well, maybe, I know we're over here, but we're going to get to go back. And there, that becomes a point where people say, well, it's still standing, and we're captive. Maybe they're not going to bring it into those at all. So any questions about the time frame, where Ezekiel is in history and that sort of thing? Let's notice, in the Bible, names mean something. A lot of times, Jesus means Savior. And Emmanuel means God's with us. That's pretty specifically fulfilled in them. But what's Ezekiel? What does his name mean? I guess you have to take my name for granted, huh? what does the lesson say? God strengthens. And Ezekiel is strengthening the people while they're all in captivity. He's over there where Daniel is. He's not prophesying to the people in Jerusalem anymore, but the city's still standing. He's over there with the captives, some of the principal ones that have gone. Because what did they leave behind? We didn't talk about this a while ago, but Nebuchadnezzar left behind what people to stay in Jerusalem and Judea area? The poorest of people. Maybe they didn't have the skills. And there again, who do we allow into our, well, we used to, who do we allow become citizens in our country? There were people that had skills. They had a job being offered. They had legal papers and that can come. You know, ours is all is kind of changed right now for different reasons. But there's a reason behind everything that people do. But here, he didn't want that. He'd bring in other captives to mix with the people he's captured. That's why we have the Samaritans. And they would not allow the people that were there as a single people would not be strong that way. They'd be weakened. And we would have the men that we can train, like Daniel, to learn the language and have his talents. But Ezekiel was over there to strengthen. He was God's man to strengthen the people and deal with the error that's being taught. And he had to be strong. And we'll see that in these opening chapters as well. So that's his name. And I think it fits him very well. Was he a priest? If so, how do we know? Let's look at Ezekiel, for example, the first chapter. And verse 3. He kind of tells us that it came to pass in the 30th year, in the fourth month, in the fifth day of the month. So he dates a lot of our prophecies of when things start. We need to be able to put that in historical place, and we'll try to do that in just a moment. We say in the fifth day of the month, which was the fifth year of King Jehoiachin's captivity. You know, he only reigned 3 years, but his captivity. He said the word of Jehovah came expressly unto Ezekiel, not the Levite, the priest. And he says that the son of Buzai in the land of the Chaldeans by the river Kibar, and the hand of Jehovah was there upon him. He's serving. So he is indeed a priest. So why would you think he's 30 years of age? Is why I think it is. Verse 1. Came to pass in the 30th year. It's not the 30th year of being in captivity. Won't work. It's not the 30th year of Nebuchadnezzar's reign. I think it's his 30th year. When did Jesus begin his ministry? When he's about how old? 30 years. Man serving God and that sort of thing. That's kind of interesting to see that's when your brain's quit growing at 25. You're done. You're going to be the best you're going to be, and we like what you see. And there he begins his prophetic work. So I think he's laying down his age. You know, there's no other reason for saying that. Just realize that this probably works better than trying to find it in the captivity area. But he does that too. But he'll let us know when that happens. So he's at the age of 30, and he is indeed a priest. Again, he's among the 10,000 captives that were taken in 597. Now we look at 2 Kings 24 and 25. Let's see Ezekiel. How does he describe this same time? Chapter 40 and verse 1. In the 5th and 20th year, which make it around 592 to 593 BC. Perfect time of if he begins his captivity in 597. But it says in the 25th year of our captivity, in the beginning of the year, in the 10th day of the month, in the 14th year after the city was smitten. So I'm taking 586, take 14 there. We know that was the time frame that we're talking about. In the selfsame day, the hand of Jehovah was upon me and brought me hither. So he was among those that indeed would be taken into captivity. And that was his reference point. In 586 BC is when the destruction of Jerusalem, 14 years later, that would put that in that time frame, 572. Just about the time we're probably seeing these prophecies take place. And seeing things occur. So that's, we're going to see it in chapter 40. We see the same thing in Kings. His prophetic work from 597 to 570 BC. How long did he prophesy? As far as we have recorded time frames of he prophesies, it would be those 27 years. Chapter 29 is the latest dated prophecy we have of Ezekiel. As we saw in Jeremiah, these are not in chronological order. We'll try to see if there's some theme or a thematic reason for having it scattered like it is. But here's the latest dated one. It came to pass in the 27th year, in the first month, in the first day of the month, the word of Jehovah came to me saying, Son of man, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. He didn't get paid well enough when he took Tyre. So God says through, I'll give him the land of Egypt. Nebuchadnezzar was his servant. Nebuchadnezzar was the one he used. And he was a rotten king. He's a foreign king, yes, but God uses kings to destroy nations. He uses other nations to destroy other nations. And that's what we see happening with the Babylonians taking the southern kingdom down, Jerusalem. What happens to the Babylonians? Handwriting's on the wall. And you got Cyrus coming along, the Medo-Persians. They're going to take care of them. Assyria, took care of their foes, and they were a powerful house, but we find that they were taken down as well by the Chaldeans. And so all of those things are happening. And I think God still works that way with nations, even though our Christ has come. But that becomes an important part too. So that's not a lot of time frame for work. But we got a whole book dealing with that. Was he a married man? And we're not a lot of little keys that we have, but when we see them, we want at least to acknowledge those. Look at chapter 24. We have an outline, 24 in verse 15. The word of Jehovah came unto me saying, did I get that right? Let's go to 8:1, and I may find why I put that there. Chapter 8 and verse 1 of Ezekiel. It came to pass in the sixth year, the sixth month, in the fifth day of the month, I sat in my house. So I had a house. And the elders of Judah sat before me at the hand of the Lord. Jehovah fell upon me. And of course, chapter 24 is where his wife, that section where his wife dies. I mean, he's a prophet, but the point is that he's going to lose his wife, and that's part of what we're seeing here as the woes that he is going through. Chapter 24, 15 says, the word of Jehovah came to me saying, Son of man, behold, I take away from thee the desire of thine eyes with a stroke. What's that? He's stunned, a stroke, you're paralyzed. I'm going to take away the desire of your eyes. And it's going to be a horrible moment for you. You won't be able to speak. And yet thou shalt neither mourn nor weep, neither shall thy tears run down, I think because of stroke. Sigh, but not aloud. Make no mourning for the dead. Bind thy head gear upon thee, and put thy shoes upon thy feet, and cover thy lips, and eat not the bread of men. I spake unto the people in mourning, and even my wife died. And I did in the morning as I was commanded, not to weep. And we'll read through there that it comes a time when he's able to speak again. And so, that's tough work. You want to be a prophet? you may lose your wife. And in a context, I don't want you mourning. You're going to be my example. No mourning, because here we're God's people doing Bob's sin, but that would involve his wife. So he had a house. He indeed was married, and that part is there. He conveys messages and signs and visions and parables. And we're not going to look at all of the ones that we have, but you have it in your outline. Let's look at just chapter 4. When something is a sign, it signifies something more important than itself. It takes us beyond the sign itself to see the importance of what it signifies, is the best way I can put it and visualize that in my mind. In Ezekiel, the 4th chapter, there's a number of them. Chapter 4 and verse 1, he says, "Take thee a tile and lay it before thee, and betray upon it a city, even Jerusalem. Lay siege against it," and so forth. "Cast up a mound against it. Set camps also against it." So you're thinking, well, the city's being besieged. We're well aware of that. Verse 3. "Take thou the iron pan and set it for a wall of iron between thee and the city, and set thy face toward it, and it shall be besieged. And thou shalt lay siege against it. This shall be a sign to the house of Israel." You're going to be besieged. You're going to be caught. It's a sign. It signifies something better than just tile and sand. What is the point? It's like a sign with a crooked arrow. That's just not to wake you up. It's to wake you up. And so you get your speeds right, because you're going to be a big old turn here. Well, that's a beautiful yellow and black sign. Quit looking at that, what it signifies. That becomes the important thing. And so there are signs and set forth. What does all of this mean? And it signifies, and he tells you what it signifies there. There are visions. And we're going to spend that first chapter. And if you've been able to read that first chapter, do you see why people think that Ezekiel saw flying saucers from outer space? Metal glowing, lights and all that sort of thing, and wheels turning. And people, well, see, those are flying saucers. That's kind of, they had UFOs back then. But it's quite a picture. It's a vision that indeed that he's setting forth there. And we see one in chapter 1, and we see one in chapter 8 when he sees a vision. "Came to pass in the 6th year, in the 6th month, 5th day of the month, I set in my house." We know he had one. "And the elders of Judah set before me, and the hand of the Lord Jehovah fell upon me. And he said, behold, lo, a likeness as the appearance of fire from the appearance of his loins, and downward fire from his loins." The idea is what he's showing him. He's showing him a vision. And verse 4, "And behold, the glory of God Israel was there according to the appearance that I saw in the plain." And so the glory of Israel is God. It's God's glorious presence being shown there. And so there's the vision that he receives. And then we're kind of familiar with Jesus in parables. What is a parable? Parable, beside, para, beside, ball, something there. You throw something beside something so you can understand. Well, it is a physical example of a spiritual truth. You put them beside each other. And he puts things beside to show the parables that are taking place. Chapter 15, "The word of Jehovah came to me, said, Son of man, what is the vine tree more than any tree? The vine branch which is among the trees of the forest?" And this is kind of interesting, because he takes on likenesses of things to understand. Would you use a vine as being something to hang your rake up on? Maybe that's, I'm not the vine itself, but just the, we would use wood. We would make nails or pegs, and that's what's happening here. And so just read, "A vine tree more than any tree, the vine branch which among the trees of the forest, shall wood be taken thereof to make any work? Or will men hang vessels on it? It's good for burning," is the point. You put a vine in the fire and it's done. It's all, if you find it in the forest. And you wouldn't use that to make your pegs, to hang up your shovels and that sort of thing. Behold, it is cast in the fire for fuel. The fire has devoured both the ends of it, and the midst of its burn. Is it profitable for any work? No. Behold, when it was whole, it was meat for no work. How much less when the fire hath devoured it, and its burn, shall it yet be meat for any work? Therefore, thus saith Jehovah, as the vine tree among the trees of the forest, which I have given to the fire for fuel, so will I give the inhabitants of Jerusalem. You're no good anymore. You're fuel for fire. What's going to happen? It's going to be burned. I will set my face against them, and they shall go forth from the fire, but the fire shall devour them, and shall know that I am Jehovah, whom I have set my face against them. I will make the land desolate because they have committed a trespass, saith the Lord Jehovah. Committed a trespass. Continue their idolatry. Manasseh, making the children go through the fire. But indeed, there is indeed a parable that set forth the significance of a vine in the forest and its usefulness. Seed for sower. And we talk about sowing the seed, and it's really the type of heart that people have, and you bring forth the meaning there. So he's seeing things, marvelous things, and it's going to be hard how you get the wheel within a wheel and it's never turning, or how does that happen? But it's remarkable how things are rolling. The idea of God's eyes seeing everything all at once is the picture you're going to see, and God bringing his visions. And this happens in the plain after the river Kibar, and it's going to come from Ezekiel to talk to them about it. I have three current needs here. Look at chapter 3, verse 7 through 9. There were people that were rebellious. And I just think God sends, they're already in captivity, but they're rebellious against God, especially in the context of how long you're going to be in captivity. He says, I'm going to send you to them, but the house of Israel will not hearken unto thee. So why am I going, God? Isaiah had the same experience. I'm using you, go to the people, they won't listen to you. And it's just something to pause. God sometimes sends his people and in situations where the end result will not be what we think. Well, we have reform. Great, Josiah, you did a good job. It may be giving them an opportunity, but what it is, it's going to harden their heart. It's God bringing forth a judgment upon them that indeed they're not going to listen. He already knows that, but he gives them the opportunity, and the word either will melt your heart or it'll harden it. And we've got to want to receive it as God would have us to do so. But it's rebellious people. I'm sending you there. Now, here's his. But the house of Israel will not hearken unto thee, for they will not hearken unto me. For all the house of Israel are of a hard forehead and of a stiff heart. Have you ever heard anybody call you a hard head? Now you know. Their forehead. Now look at Ezekiel. What's going to happen? Behold, I have made thy face hard against their faces, and thy forehead hard against their foreheads. As an adamant harder than flint have I made thy forehead. Don't fear them. Fear them not, neither be dismayed at their looks, though they are a rebellious house. That's why you have hard-headed preachers. You got hard-headed people, and you can't fear them. You've got to do what God would have you to do. In verse 11, and go get children of people and speak to them and tell them, thus saith the Lord, whether they will hear or whether they will forbear. It'll be up to them, but God will hold them responsible. But he gives us an opportunity to hear the word. And I think Cornelius is an example. Your prayers are heard. He's an alien sinner, but his prayers are heard because he was looking for, apparently his heart was, he was receptive to the gospel. He just needed the opportunity. And God heard his prayer, and he said, I'm sending you a messenger. I'm sending you the preacher. And he taught him the gospel. It's Peter. But sometimes he's sending it to give you an opportunity to hang yourself.
You won't ever be able to make an excuse in judgment. But when people's heart gets rebellious, here's the word, they do not want to receive it because they don't want to serve God. Ezekiel was the man of God. He was God's man on this occasion to do a very difficult job. You've got to be committed to God, being told that your work will not change them, but it will simply harden them to the point where indeed the just God is just when he burns them to the ground. Secondly, false prophets telling of immediate return. This is where I mentioned a while ago, this becomes a problem. And in Ezekiel, the 13th chapter, let's read that in verse 16. We see that this was occurring. Let me go up to verse 15. Thus will I accomplish my wrath upon the wall and upon them that have daubed it with untempered martyr. Here's the false teachers. Chapter 13 is a great prophecy. What is false teaching? Though I don't read where they're called false prophets. Peter calls them false prophets in the New Testament. I don't read it here. But so what makes them false? Because you didn't label them that way. And it's just a matter of semantics. You see what a false prophet is in Peter when you have times like this, when they're prophesying what? Is their attitude wrong? Or is that the problem that makes a false prophet? It's not what you teach. Their teaching was error. It was wrong. That's what makes a false prophet. Well, his heart's good, and if your heart's bad, that makes you false. You're false that way. But a teacher is false in his teaching. So he said, they're just untempered martyr. I was saying to you, the wall is no more, neither they that daubed it, to wit the prophets of Israel that prophesy concerning Jerusalem, that see visions of peace for her, and there is no peace, saith the Lord Jehovah. There's no peace. They think they're going to be able to come back. And Jeremiah is one that speaks about the details there. But look at chapter 28. That's our last one up there. Chapter 28 and verses 2 and 3. Here's prophet Hananiah, the son of Azur, the prophet, who was of Gibeon, spake unto me in the house of Jehovah in the presence of the priest and all the people, saying, thus speaketh Jehovah of hosts, the God of Israel, saying, I've broken the yoke of the king of Babylon. Within 2 full years will I bring again this place, all the vessels Jehovah's house and with that Nebuchadnezzar king had taken in 2 years. This is the beginning of the reign of Zedekiah in the fourth year of his reign, that indeed over here Jeremiah was dealing with people who were, and there was that where 2 years we're going to have it back. They said, we're going to be back. Ezekiel, the people over there are saying, we'll be out of here pretty quickly. And it's that 2 year period that's being prophesied by Jeremiah. Okay. We'll have to stop there. But the idea of immediate return, did they come back? Were both of them right? Did they come back from captivity? 70 years they did, didn't they? So we say, hey, it is up. Hey, it's just a wash. It's just a wash. No, it's not. That's false teaching. You don't do it exactly the way God said it. It's not right. And I want to emphasize that. And maybe we'll talk about that more. He cares what he says. And when he says 70 years, it's going to be 70. And I'm prophesying in the name of Jehovah. That didn't work, did it? Any comments that you like to make? The captivity doomed for Jerusalem, even though captivity has already taken place, Deuteronomy 33:21. Ezekiel's talking to people that think, well, maybe it's not going to be bad, and he's going to have to tell them, and he's going to give them the good news too. So we'll talk about that.